Shabbat Shalom, everyone.
Shabbat Shalom.
It is a joy to be here today, and I want everybody to know how excited I am to have my granddaughter and her husband Peter here with us today. It's an exciting time for me. In case you haven't ever noticed, I do love my granddaughter. I don't make any pretenses about that. She's one of the joys of my life. So hope everybody gets to meet everybody else. Get around and greet one another. And want to welcome Zach today to be with us. And he's with Rick and Cindy and the kids. So it's good to have you here with us, Zach. Thank you for coming and joining us. And thank all of you for being here. I would ask once again, please, no questions or comments during the teaching, but we will address any questions or comments later on during the Midrash portion. Today I want to talk to you about the coming kingdom, and I have put down, oh, what a day. If you've noticed in our reading today that the kingdom doesn't come until there's first a cleansing. Did you notice that? Both in the portion we read from Bereshit chapter 19 as well as Luke chapter 17, there always comes a cleansing and then the kingdom is ushered in. So I want to look carefully today at Luke 17. I was really blessed this week. I knew that Heather and Peter were coming. And I was wondering, how am I going to put together a teaching, because I wanted to spend time with them as well. And usually I'm over here 4 or 5 hours a day studying. But Yahweh made it possible that first day, I came over here and things just poured out and I completed the whole thing in one day. So I am very blessed to have had that take place. Our teaching today actually is going to begin in Luke chapter 17. However, I want to take a step back a little bit and look first at chapter 16 to kind of set the stage for what we're going to be doing. I want to remind all of you, most of you came out of the church setting, of one denomination or another. And if you'll remember that when you were in the religious system really relies heavily on the words of the risen Savior, Yeshua HaMashiach. In fact, I can recall when I was a pastor having the deacons of my church come in and sat down with me. And we had a discussion, and one of the men who was one of the deacons told me that he does not believe anything in the Bible except that which is written in red. And I thought to myself, it's kind of an odd statement to make, because if you don't know what's written in black, which preceded that, then you don't even know what he's talking about. That's
right.
Really.
That's right.
But if that were true, then and it is true, that's very important what Yeshua has to say. But I want to look at what did he say. Luke chapter 16, verse 29 and following. Abraham said to him, "They have Moshe and the prophets. Let them hear them." And he said, "No, Father Abraham. But if someone from the dead goes to them, they shall repent." But he said to them, "If they do not hear Moshe and the prophets, neither would they be persuaded, even if one should rise from the dead." Now some people may miss this, but this is by inspiration, and it may be Abraham who's speaking the words, but the direction to speak the words came out of the mouth of Yeshua himself. And so, Yeshua is really talking here about himself, the fact that he has risen from the dead. What I wanted you to notice here is in verse 30 that he says, if someone from the dead goes to them, they shall repent. Will they?
Mm-mm.
Yeshua himself says here, if they will not hear the Moshe or the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, even if someone rises from the dead and goes to them. He rose from the dead. Now I want you to stop and think about something today. We have people in the religious system today who will absolutely not hear the truth of the Torah. Even though Yeshua rose from the dead, and every single teaching that he did came from Moshe and the prophets. He didn't speak anything that was really new. He quoted many times directly out of the Tanakh. And so, let's begin to look. Now consider what Yeshua just said, and let's look at another verse. Keep in mind, he said, and I'll break it down this way. What he was actually saying is, even if I raise from the dead and I go to them, they won't believe. They won't accept. They won't repent. Well, let's look at another verse. In Yohanan, John chapter 5, 46 and 47, he says, now listen very carefully. If you believed Moshe, you would have believed me, since he wrote about me. But if you do not believe his writings, how shall you believe my words? I don't know how important this is to you, but I pray that it'll become very, very important to you. Because I want you to think again what he just said. He just told you that that which is from the beginning is about him. Everything that was written, everything Moshe put pen to, was about Yeshua, the Messiah. He said, you must believe in the writings of Moshe. If you believe in the writings of Moshe, you'll have no trouble believing me. But what has happened to the religious system? They've cast out, done away with the writings of Moses, and saying, that doesn't apply to us today. So essentially, they don't believe the writings of Moshe. And so then Yeshua says, then you won't believe me because he wrote about me. If you don't believe his writings, how will you believe me? If we don't have the foundation laid, how are we going to build on that foundation? How are we going to have a renewed covenant with no foundation? How are we able to build anything without a foundation? It's impossible to do. The foundation of every teaching concerning Yeshua can be traced back to the Psalms and the prophets. All of them. In fact, many people don't know this, but within the first three chapters of the book of Bereshit, Genesis, you will find every major doctrine of the religious system today. Every major doctrine is within those first three chapters, but you have to know how to look for them. You have to do some research. This is where Yeshua is drawing material to instruct his talmidim, his taught ones. How many times have I taught this thing that I'm about to say? When Yeshua was teaching, he did not have a King James 1611 Bible. What did he have? He had the scrolls of the prophets and Moshe. That's what he taught from. He didn't have a New Testament. And so we know it can't possibly be that he taught his talmidim from Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. He taught them the words of the Tanakh. Verse 1 of Luke 17, and he said to his taught ones, it is inevitable that stumbling blocks should come, but woe to him through whom they come. Mm-hmm. I don't know why it is that a lot of people in the religious system think that once they become born again, born from above, they're not going to have any problems. Everything is going to be smooth sailing. Let me tell you, the stumbling blocks began the day you gave your life to Yeshua, the day you were born from above. And you can expect that. But Yeshua says, but woe to him through whom they come. He will deal with it. This was a lesson that was very hard for me. I'm the kind of guy who likes to defend myself. If you step on my toes, I will defend myself. It took a long time for me to accept and understand what my wife was trying to tell me, is you don't need to do that. You have a defender. His name is Yeshua. You turn it over to him and let him handle it. And if I do that, I won't sin, because frankly, if I defend myself, I could find myself embedded in sin. But if I turn it over to him, he'll handle it, and I won't have to be concerned about that. There will be those who place stumbling blocks or offenses in your path, so expect them. What you may not expect, though, is who is going to be doing the majority of the placing of stumbling blocks and offenses. The question isn't, will there be some? But rather, how many will there be? And where will they come from? And who will put them there? And I'll assure you that it's going to be the people you least suspect. These are booby traps in your path. Be aware of the possibility and know that they will usually be placed by those you love. Does that surprise you? It's going to be people like your mother, your father, your sister, your brother, your cousins, whoever, that are going to place stumbling blocks in your path. And they are very good at devising schemes and ways to do that. I've seen it over and over and over. Where they give you a tough decision about, do I keep the Moedim or do I do what my family wants me to do? For instance, if you don't celebrate Christmas with us, then you don't love us. Right? If you ask me to celebrate Christmas with you, you don't love me. That's my response.
I wish I would have.
What I would encourage all of you to do is become a member of Yah's EOD team. You know what an EOD is?
Yes.
Explosive Ordnance
Department.
Yeah. Disarm them with the Torah. Don't try to disarm them with statements from yourself. Use the Torah.
Amen.
Your enemy knows a perverted Torah. Do you know Satan knows a perverted Torah? He quoted Torah to Yeshua. But he perverted it. He tried to trick him. This is going to happen. People are going to take the Torah, twist the words to try to get you to believe a false teaching, a false doctrine. But you know the truth. Every single week I end every teaching by saying, study to show yourselves approved. If you do that, then you can disarm anybody, because you have the Torah in your heart and in your mind, and the Ruach HaKodesh will bring it to your memory, and you can defend yourself quite easily. Use it as a weapon in your arsenal. Verse 2 says, it would be better for him if a millstone is put around his neck and he were thrown into the sea, than that he should cause one of these little ones to stumble. Yeshua is telling you there would better be a weight placed around his neck and him thrown into the sea and drowned than to cause you to stumble. So you see, we don't have to defend ourselves. He will take care of it come judgment day. We may think, and they may think, that they got away with it scot-free. They may think they offended you, and nothing's going to happen. But when they stand before him on the judgment day, He's going to put a millstone around their neck, and he's going to throw them into the sea. And that sea, he referred to as the lake of fire. Yeshua speaks of the death of the offender. The one who sets the trap is going to be caught in his own devices. They set the trap for you, but if you'll allow him to, Yeshua will re-rig it so that it traps them. And they become the ultimate victim and not you. Take heed to yourselves. If your brother sins against you, rebuke him. And if he repents, forgive him. And if he sins against you 7 times in a day, and 7 times in a day comes back to you saying, I repent, you shall forgive him. First of all, let me remind you that when he says, saying, I repent, he's making teshuvah. He is asking for forgiveness and saying, I did you wrong. But I want you to pay attention to something in verse 3 that not many people see. If your brother sins against you, rebuke him. What's the next line? If he repents, forgive him. I've been taught most of my life as a Christian that I had to forgive everybody regardless. These are out of the mouth of Yeshua. If he repents, forgive him. What if he does not repent? Then, according to Yeshua HaMashiach, I owe him no forgiveness. Right? And when he talks in verse 4, he's saying that if he comes back 7 times in a day and he truly repents, then you shall forgive him. We had the opportunity to watch Amish Grace again the other night in the movie. I encourage anybody that's not seen that movie, get it and watch it. It's called Amish Grace. You will see forgiveness like you couldn't even imagine. I won't tell you what it's about. I'd rather you get the movie and see it. Somehow we tend to overlook words in Scripture. Did you know that? If he repents is in the verse. If the offender truly repents, forgive him. If there's no repentance, there's no forgiveness. Do you think that Yeshua really forgives a person who doesn't repent?
No.
If they come and ask him to forgive them, but they're going to keep on doing what they were doing, you think there's no repentance there. You think he really forgives that? You think he's a sacrifice for that? Not likely, right? We also tend to overlook these words, rebuke him. Yes, forgive him, but remind him that this kind of behavior will not be tolerated in the future. And by the way, one of the reasons that I was asked to leave a church that I pastored was because I publicly rebuked one of the members. But I will remind you, if you will go into the New Testament, the Brit Hadasha, you will find Yeshua saying, rebuke them publicly. He doesn't say rebuke them in private. He says do it publicly in front of everybody. Now I was told, well, you're not supposed to shame somebody, you know. Rebuking someone is not intended to shame them. Rebuking them is to let them know that, yes, I will forgive you, but don't do this again. If you do this again, it's going to be a different outcome. Okay? Because that means you did not repent. You went right back and did the same thing again. Let's look at the word repent. Repent is from a Hebrew word, nacham. Nacham means to be sorry for something, but not just to be sorry, but to be sorry in the depth of your very being. And the reason I want you to notice is nacham, the Hebrew word, is formed with the Hebrew letters That first one reading right to left, the first one is a nun. The second one is a hep. The last one is a mem sophit, right? Okay. So it's formed with a nun, which means life. Nun means life. Het means a fence or to divide. And the mem sophit means chaos. So if I take those and put them together so that they form the word nacham, I find it means to remove division which causes chaos and to restore life. This is what it means to repent. You see how wonderful Hebrew is? It's an absolutely beautiful language. In verse 5, and the emissary said to the master, give us more belief. Help me to believe. Help me to have more faith. Well, give us more belief. The word belief here is the Hebrew word emunah. Emunah, though, means something that grabs hold, something that supports something else, or the passing of strength or skill to the next generation. And so, if he's going to give us more belief, what they are asking for is a better understanding of the word of Yahweh, the Torah. This is what they will grab hold of. This is what will support their life. And this is what hopefully gives them strength, develops skill, and this is something they pass on to the next generation. In other words, Yeshua is saying, or they're saying rather, teach us more, give us a support system that will strengthen us so that we might pass it on to our children and our children's children. This is exactly what he's talking about when he tells parents, teach your children. Teach them in their rising up and in their going out. Teach them. The disciples were thirsty for righteousness, not unlike perhaps some of you today. Some of you who are in this room. Some of you who are watching by way of the internet. You're saying, I want to be more righteous. I want to be more like the Messiah. I want to do the things that are right and avoid the things that are wrong. I want to walk the narrow path rather than the broad path. Well, how do I do that? I learn from the Torah how to do that. I study the lessons that Yahweh Elohim has given. Verse 6, and the master said, if you have belief as a mustard seed, you would say to this mulberry tree, be pulled up by the roots and be planted by the sea, and it would obey you. Now, you've probably heard many lectures or sermons on how big a mustard seed is. It's one of the smallest seeds on earth, but it grows into a gigantic plant. Spreads out a lot. The mulberry tree is best translated sycamore tree. This tree is known to have a strong root system, some of them lasting well over 600 years. But many trees well over 600 years old. He goes on to say, but who of you, having a servant plowing or shepherding, would say to him when he's come in from the field, come immediately and sit down to eat? But would he not rather say to him, prepare somewhat for my supper, and gird yourself and serve me while I eat and drink, and afterward you shall eat and drink. Now if you'll remember from reading Bereshit 19 today, what did Lot do? He went in and had food prepared for them. He served them and stood by and watched them eat, didn't he? So Yeshua is actually making an allegory against that was written in the 19th chapter of Bereshit. We learned last week that hospitality was extended to visitors and guests, not to servants. However, in this case, the servant worked for his supper. If the servant works for his supper, if he labors for his supper, would you not feed him? Would you not bring him in and sit him down and feed him? Would you not serve him drink? This is what Yeshua is talking about. Would he thank that servant because he did what he was commanded? Yeshua says, I think not. Now, we have believers today in the Hebrew roots, in the Messianic move, however you want to explain it, whatever label you want to put on it, think that if I keep his commandments, then I should expect something in return. He should thank me because I kept his commandments. We forget we're the servant, he's the king. He gives the commandment. We should not expect him to thank us for carrying out his command. I served 22 years in the military, and beloved people, I never one time had a commanding officer come to me and say, Jim, thank you for carrying out my orders. Not one time did that ever happen. And I never expected that to happen. And I don't expect Yahweh Elohim to thank me for keeping his commandments. Does Yahweh thank us when we obey his commandments? He does, however, bless us, doesn't he? What does he bless us for, though? Obedience. For doing what he said to do. But he doesn't come down and say, oh, thank you so much. I thank you from the bottom of my heart. But if you will do it, he's already said he will bless you. It's a promise that comes from the beginning. So also you, when you have done all that you were commanded, say, we are unworthy servants. We have done what was our duty to do. It's going to be a sad day on that day when we all appear before the Bema seat of the Messiah. And he says to us, did you obey my commandments? And the only answer is yes or no. I either did or I didn't. Right? And we will find then why, what it means to be blessed. I served 22 years in the military, including 3 combat tours in Vietnam. I do not consider myself a hero at all. I simply did what I was commanded to do. Now, I don't mean to take anything away from our servicemen. I love them, bless them all. But it's gotten totally out of hand with this hero thing. If a man serves in the military, he's a hero. If a man is a police officer, he's a hero. If he's a fireman, he's a hero. No, they are men doing the job that they're commanded to do. Now, when they go above and beyond that, then they become a hero. I was no hero. I did what I was supposed to do. I didn't do anything. I was no Audie L. Murphy. Okay? So I didn't expect to be called a hero. But I likewise didn't expect to be called a raper of women and a killer of babies. I didn't expect that either. Why is it that in this time frame, if someone serves in the military, they're a hero? Why is that? I remember in Vietnam, in the Vietnam era, we came back, we weren't heroes, folks. I can tell you that. And it came to be as he went to Jerusalem, that he passed through the midst of Shomron and Galil. And he was entering into a certain village. He was met by 10 leprous men who stood at a distance. 10 men with leprosy. The number 10, as used here, denotes men who were separated. Men who were cut off. Men who were severed from society. Recognize Yeshua as a kosher rabbi. They remained at a distance. They were not allowed to touch him at all. And I've even read some accounts where some people say they weren't even allowed to talk to him. They lifted their voice saying, "Yeshua, Master, have compassion on us." And having seen them, he said to them. Now this is very interesting. Look what he says here. "Go show yourself to the priest." And it came to be that as they were going, they were cleansed. "Yeshua, Master, have compassion on us." He didn't say, "Be healed." He said, "Go show yourselves to the priest." Where did he get the idea that they should go show themselves to the priest? From the Torah.
Torah instruction.
That's what they were commanded to do if they had leprosy, was go to the priest. Yeshua tells them, "Go show yourself to the priest." Right? I hope you see what I see. Yeshua did not lay hands on them. He did not pray for them. He did not spit on them. He referred them to the priest. As they obeyed, they were cleansed. Now, am I right?
Yeah.
Do you see there where he prayed for them, or where he laid his hands on them and said, "Be healed," or any of that? Or he cast out demons? Cast out the demon of leprosy or any of that kind of stuff?
No.
No. He said, "Do what the Torah says. Go show yourself to the priest." As they obeyed, they didn't even get to the priest. As they obeyed, as they were on their way, the healing took place. You know why? Because they were obedient and did what he said do. Right? What would have happened had they said, "We're New Testament believers. We're not under the law."
Then they would not
have been healed. Right.
And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, returned to Teshuvah, praising Elohim with a loud voice. And he fell down on his face at his feet, giving thanks to him. And he was a Shomerai knight. You know what that is? Anybody? First of all, who was he worshiping?
Yeshua.
He bowed down at his feet. He worshiped Yeshua, the one who had brought his healing, right? And Yeshua answering said, "Were there not 10 cleansed? Did I not cleanse 10 lepers? But where are the 9? Was no one found to return to give praise to Elohim except for this foreigner?" He was a Samaritan. That's what a Shomronite is, a Samaritan. Okay. Except this foreigner. See, the Yehudim wouldn't have much to do with anybody that was from that part of the country. They just didn't have anything to do with him, wouldn't eat with him, had virtually no contact. But here you have a Yehuda, Yeshua, who heals him and reacts with him. This man was a Samaritan, indicating that the others were all Israelite. So the only one that came back was a member of the nations. He came back to worship Yeshua, but the Israelites did not. And 9, by the way, is the number for judgment. So 1 came back, 9 were going to be judged. And he said to them, "Rise, go your way. Your what? Your belief has made you well." Now I want you to know that we just read what made them well is their obedience. Isn't that what they just said? Now he's saying your belief has made you well. Now what I want you to see is that obedience and faith or belief are coupled together, mm-hmm. right? You cannot have one without the other. If I say I'm a person of faith, then I'm a person who is obedient. And if I'm a person who shows faith, I have obedience. And if I'm obedient, it is absolute proof that I have faith. Right? Rise, go your way, it's made you well. Well here is an interesting word. Yasha. Does that sound familiar? Yasha? Yashua? Yasha? Means to be rescued, to be preserved, or have salvation. So what did Yeshua just tell this man? Your belief has given you salvation. Right? It has preserved you. It has rescued you from this disease. And you have salvation. This Samaritan was healed physically and spiritually as well. You see, I don't believe Yeshua heals physically without healing spiritually. And having been asked by the Pharisees when the reign of Elohim would come, he answered them and said, the reign of Elohim does not come with intent watching. Nor shall they say, look here or look there, for look, the reign of Elohim is in your midst. Now notice the Pharisees, they're looking for a Messiah who is going to come and be a warring Messiah who destroys all of their enemies and gives them the land, and that's not who Yeshua was. Yeshua was the suffering servant when he came the first time. But notice he says, the reign of Elohim does not come with intense watching. In other words, if I... and always looking and watching for it, he said that's not going to cause it to get here quicker. Right? Now, how many people do you remember in the religious system who said something to the effect that we're watching and waiting for the day that Yeshua comes back? Yeshua is saying you don't have to do that, because why? It's in your midst. What does that mean? It's in you. He is in you. The kingdom of Elohim is in you. It is a part of you. I mean, when will the throne of Elohim come? When will the king come? And how will we know? Why do we look here and there? His throne is within the believer. Isn't that what the scriptures teach us, folks? Do you not know that you are the dwelling place of Elohim and that the spirit of Elohim dwells in you? The kingdom is in you. The king is enthroned in you. So if we're looking for it, we don't have very far to look. How often do we forget this? We go where we should not go. We say what we should not say. We do what we should not do. And we don't do what we should do. And he said to the taught ones, day shall come when you shall long to see one of the days of the Son of Adam, but you shall not see it. Have you seen one of those days? Have you seen a day when life just crashes in on you? Do you not cry out, come Master, come now? I can remember when I was a pastor in the traditional church hearing people all of the time say, oh, come Lord Jesus, come right now. And the truth of the matter is, they did not want him to come right now. You know why? They're not ready. They're not prepared. They're walking opposite of what the Torah says. Unfortunately, in the Hebrew roots, we also have people who are not ready. We must prepare ourselves, and we do that according to the word, the Torah. Relax, he is here. If you are born from above, he's in your midst. Call on his name, his authority, and his power. He is seated on the throne of your heart. He is with you. And they shall say to you, look here or look there. Do not go after them nor follow. For as the lightning that flashes out of one part under heaven shines to the other part under heaven, so also the Son of Adam shall be in his day. What is he really saying to us here? We will not have to look for him. Every eye will see him when he comes. He will light up the skies with his splendor. One of the things that I have never understood is I have heard many sermons preached about he's going to come as a thief in the night. He's going to come when you least expect it. You're not going to know it, and boom, there he is. Okay? But yet he tells us when he comes that the heavens will shake and the earth will tremor. He says that the sound of the shofar gadol will split the heavens. He says that he will come from east to west. I don't think that's coming in as a thief in the night, do you? And he also says very clearly, every eye will see him when he comes. So that's not coming in. The idea is they don't know what it means to be a thief in the night. They have no idea what that means. Does anybody in here not know what that means? You don't know what that means? In the olden days when they had the priest and they had the temple standing, Yahweh Elohim commanded that the fire on the altar never go out, that it burn continually. So what the priest would do, the high priest would assign, they would draw by lots. One of the priests who got the short stick or whatever, however they did it, he would be designated to keep the fire going on the altar all night. Well, he's no different than some of the night guards nowadays. They fall asleep. So what would happen, the high priest would slip in like a thief in the night. And if he caught the priest sleeping, he would go take a hot coal off of the fire and he would bring it and sit it on the garment of the priest who was sleeping. And the priest who was sleeping would be awakened on fire. That's where the expression as a thief in the night comes from. So when Yeshua says, he'll come as a thief in the night, he's saying be vigilant, be awake. Don't be slothful, don't be sleeping. But first he has to suffer much and be rejected by this generation. Yeshua is telling them that he has to be crucified, that he has to suffer. I see a wonderful teaching buried within the next few verses. And perhaps one of these days I'll put together a teaching on it. We all know it speaks of eschatology. Eschatology is the study of the end times. And there's a lot of people out there who claim they are scholars concerning eschatology, the study of the end times. The only problem I have with them is they begin in the middle or at the end and go backwards. And if you're going to be studying prophecy, eschatology, you need to start at the beginning. And it came to be in the days of Noah, so also shall it be in the days of the Son of Adam. So when Yeshua just said he'll come back as the Son of Adam, when he does come back, this scripture tells us that it'll be like it was in the days of Noah. Now, the question is, what was it like in the days of Noah? I've heard a lot of sermons preached about the fact that there was a lot of homosexuality. That's what we just read in Bereshit today about Lot and what the men there in Sodom were wanting to do. But look what it says in verse 27. They were eating, they were drinking, they were marrying, they were given in marriage until the day that Noah went into the ark, and the flood came and destroyed them all. Well, we know one thing, there was homosexuality. And I can't help but wonder if it wasn't the fact that when it says they were given in marriage, that they were having same-sex marriage. Because it was homosexuality. But that's not really all it means to be in the days of Noah. What it meant is to not see all of the signs, to not be awake, to not be observing. They were doing their own thing. They were eating. They were getting married. They were giving in marriage. And what was Noah doing? He was constantly telling them. But they looked at him and said, "You're a crazy old coot. What is this thing you're building?" And they had never seen it rain. Rain had never happened. And so they didn't understand that a flood was going to come. And the ark was to be their salvation, right? Well, look at what's going on today. They're ignoring every warning that he could possibly give them. And they're going on right on with what they want to do. Whatever gives them pleasure, that's what they're doing today. It's going to result in worldwide destruction of people by the billions. There will truly be a remnant. Society has become so desensitized that they have no expectation of judgment. They think they can do whatever they want to do, any way they want to do it, for as long as they want to do it, and nothing is going to happen. In Noah's day, it cost them their lives by water. There was a flood, and they all drowned. Now, I want you to stop and think about this. I can picture, just as Noah's ark began to lift off the ground, okay? The doors on the ark were closed. Nobody could go in. There must have been thousands of people outside the ark, as the water kept rising and the ark kept rising. They began to cry out and scream for their lives. It was too late. Now Yahweh says, "I will not contend with man forever."
Amen.
There is a time when you better do what you need to do. Well, what's going to happen in this generation? Water won't be the answer. And likewise, as it came to be in the days of Lot, they were eating, they were drinking, they were buying, they were selling. They were planting, they were building. But on the day Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and sulfur from heaven and destroyed all of them. See, the same thing, and this is all warnings of what's going to happen to this generation, that are the same as they were in the days of Noah. But they won't listen. The very same thing happened in Lot's time that happened before. "It shall be the same in the day the Son of Adam is revealed." Do you see that? I'm not kidding you. You see it? Yeshua says, "It shall be the same in the day that the Son of Adam is revealed." When he comes from east to west, look how many people are going to be destroyed. Now, a lot of people say, "Well, I don't think God would ever do that." Yes, he will. Otherwise, he cannot be a just Elohim. It would be unfair if he went back against his word. Right? You must accept the salvation, or the sacrifice, rather, of Yeshua. All right? Otherwise, you're doomed. When Yeshua returns, the very same thing is going to happen. "In that day," listen carefully, "in that day, he who shall be on the housetop and his goods in the house, let him not come down to take them away." Don't come back and get your worldly goods. Now's not a time to worry about worldly goods. Now's not a time to worry about material things. Now is a time to make sure you're spiritually prepared. "And likewise, the one who is in the field, let him not turn back." Do you remember the wife of Lot, Yeshua says? How many of you remember what happened to her? She was turned into a cow lick. She was. She looked back and said, oh, I wish I was back there in Sodom. And Yahweh turned her into a pillar of salt. That's a salt lick, right? What happened when she looked back? I just said, whoever seeks to save his life shall lose it, and whoever loses his life shall preserve it. I say to you, in that night there shall be two in one bed. The one shall be taken, and the other shall be left. Two shall be grinding together. The one shall be taken, the other shall be left. Two shall be in the field. The one shall be taken, and the other shall be left. Now, I heard a sermon preached on this, that was all about homosexuals. They were all homosexuals who were in the bed, in the field together. That had nothing to do with homosexuality, okay? This is talking about the wheat and the tares, the believers and the unbelievers, right? This addresses again the wheat and the tares, or the darnel, as it's called, in Matthew 13:30. Let both grow together. Let the wheat and the tares grow together until the harvest. And at the time of the harvest, I shall say to the reapers, first gather the darnel and bind them in bundles and burn them, but gather the wheat into my granary. Now, gather the darnel, bind them into bundles to burn them. How would they at that time identify the difference between the darnel, the tares, and the wheat? They look just alike growing in the field. You can't tell one from the other until they ripen. Once they become ready, the wheat bows. The darnel refuses to bow, stands upright. So Yeshua says, let them grow together until the harvest, when you can identify one from the other. At that time, go in and separate them, burn the tares, but put the wheat into my granary. The book addressing Left Behind, you have anybody seen that? It's a good fiction novel, but it has no relation to the truth of Scripture. None whatsoever. And they answering said to him, where, Master? And he said to them, where the body is, there also the eagles shall be gathered together. Did you ever notice that some of the things Yeshua says don't make any sense? You know why that is? We don't have the foundational teaching. So we don't know what he's saying. You notice they didn't say, what are you talking about? What do you mean by that? They knew what he meant by it. He's giving them an illustration. They clearly understood what he meant. We may not understand it. Verse 37 speaks of flesh-eating vultures. Instead of eagles, these are birds of prey. And, of course, eagles eat flesh too. So this is just one species of vultures that eat flesh. He said, they shall be gathered together. Now, why would they be gathered together? What did he just say? That all of these people are going to be destroyed. Mm-hmm. Right? What's going to be one of the ways of cleaning it up? Flesh-eating vultures. That's their intent, right? Until next time, study to show yourself approved. Shalom Aleichem.
Where do we start?